It is important also that that gets accompanied by a number of things, including justice, including equality. So, of course, many people always ask the question, what is the fate and what is the situation now with regards to the newest African countries? And often they'll point to Namibia, they'll point to Eritrea, and they'll point to South Sudan. So the question then is, do we need another country? And shouldn't we be working rather towards a truly united Africa? And I say yes, we all should. It is important that we work towards a truly united Africa. But for that to happen, we need to consider that for unity to be in place, there is need for us to prioritize equal rights for everyone. There is need for us to prioritize justice, because without justice and equal rights, no amount of work and talk towards unity is going to be fruitful. And I'm giving a few examples that make it necessary for us as Southern Cameroonians to argue today that we would want to have and see an independent Southern Cameroons. We don't want to be part of a country where your education curriculum is being developed in another country. Cameroon has gone into a 50-year contract with France, which is renewable every 50 years. That says we don't have the right to develop our own school curriculum for our children. You are going to develop it for us, send it, and then we just teach our children. And that is the reason why people like myself, for several years, in fact, for my whole life, we got miseducated into thinking things and believing things that don't exist. So I don't want to be part of that kind of country. And what you've seen as images this morning that our Ambassador Jesse has just presented is no accident, and it's not an accidental brutality. It is a very well-orchestrated, calculated ploy to subdue our people. In the 50s and the 60s, the same Republic of Cameroon, the French Cameroon, employed the same tactics on its own people. And we are told that perhaps the one genocide that has taken place on this African continent that's not been spoken about took place then between the 50s and the 60s, when approximately 450 to 500,000 people were killed. And what they did was this scorched earth policy, where if one military person is killed in your village, they descend on your village and they kill everything, every woman, every child, everything. And then they make sure that they send an example. When you see them slitting the throat of the gentleman, it is no accident. It is sending a clear message to the rest of us to say, this is what we'll do to your mothers, to your fathers, to your brothers, to whoever else is left if you do what you're doing. So it is no accident. And I know that we are in no position to complain about violence, because a whole lot of people across the continent have experienced it. But there are other issues that we need to talk about quickly, and the fact that when we talk about this, and often the argument that we must try and maintain unity, and in this case, one and indivisible Cameroon, then what happens is that in the course of that argument, ultimately it is the forgotten masses that bear the brunt of this vicious quest for power, for glory, and unfettered access to natural resources. Very often, this kind of marginalization and treatment stems from the fact that these people are looking to access our resources. It is not out of the pleasure of doing it. And when Prof did his presentation, he talked about the immutable nature of the state that was created in 1961. That said, the nature of the federal system under no circumstances should be touched. But in 1972, or prior to 1972, when the French, and I mean France, realized that Southern Cameroons was blessed with abundant oil resources, then they came up with this idea of a united Cameroon, and thereby subsuming the Southern Cameroons into French Cameroon and making Southern Cameroons party to the 50-year deal that French Cameroon had signed with France, which means that France can access our resources at any time because we happen to be one of its subjects. And that is basically the reason for where we are today. Second, and as a result, and to cement this decision and relationship, in 1984, French Cameroon President Mr. Biya decided to sign a presidential decree that said that moving forward, we have become what is now called the Republic of Cameroon. So what was then the Federal Republic moved to a United Republic and then back to the Republic of Cameroon. So we basically moved back to French Cameroon as it was in 1960, thereby losing completely the identity of Southern Cameroons. So by French Cameroon parlance, Southern Cameroons does not exist anymore. And that is what is being resisted today. So the question is, when we are talking about Southern Cameroons, what are we talking about? Is this another failed state? Are we moving towards another failed state? This is the fear of many Pan-Africanists. And true, maybe you are right. It is true that we may end up being another failed state, but at least we got given the chance to make our mistakes. If we end up being a failed state, it is our choice and our chance. Last year, in the middle of last year, I had a meeting with a gentleman who is widely regarded or considered to be the next president of Finland. When I visited Finland, and we sat and had the same debates, very impressive in terms of his understanding of the situation on the continent. And he said, listen, there are discussions on your situation in Southern Cameroons globally. And where we are, you have got one of four choices. The first is to maintain the status quo as it is, as you are today. The second is to have some kind of limited autonomy. The third is to have a federal system. And the fourth is complete independence. And he told me that as far as the international community is concerned, forget about the fourth option. Complete independence is out. Forget about it. So you've got three options to choose from. Maintaining the status quo, limited autonomy, or a federal system. My response was that, forget about the first two. We are not even going to talk about them. But when we talk about the third option, we are going to consider a confederal system. We could think about that. And he argued and said, what do you mean by that? I said, we will have complete autonomy over our territory, and that includes autonomy and control of our military. And he said, but that doesn't make sense. That's as much as you're saying we want our independence. And I said, well, you gave me four options. I've chosen the option. We'll go for the third option according to the international community, but we'll have complete control over everything, including our military. Why? Because if there is anything that French Cameroon has used to subdue our people all these years, is the use of the military. We will not accept to go into any kind of relationship that says we are going to have a common military of which every time they recruit 1,000 boys, six of them come from our region. Six. And of the six, they throw them to different parts of the country to make sure that the six never get together and come up with a common plan. That is inconceivable. That's something we are not going to consider. Now, the situation has always been one of comparing the case of Southern Cameroons and the other African countries, the new independent African countries. And I chose to do a quick comparison to South Sudan, partly because I spent a year in South Sudan and understand a bit of the dynamics. But I would want to say Eritrea might be a country with its own problems, but it is a country that is independent. Namibia is a good example of a country that has chosen the right path. And I'm sure that as Southern Cameroons, we can decide what path we want to choose. And there is the diction or the argument that newly independent African countries tend to go towards a certain route is false, because Namibia has shown that you can actually choose the right route where there is good governance, where there are democratic principles. And of course, I'm not saying that Namibia is 100% perfect, but it is one of the best on the continent as we speak. Now, looking at the similarities and what we need to fear with regards to the Southern Cameroons compared to South Sudan is the similarities in history and the exploitation and the marginalization. Exact same story. Anybody who's taken the time to understand what Khartoum and in fact all the way to Cairo was doing to South Sudan was basically one of exploitation of everything that was South Sudanese, but ensuring to subdue and subjugate the South Sudanese to the point where they had no identity. It has been the exact same thing in our case. But then when, as a South Sudanese, I could argue, for instance, that this has been done to me by the Arabs because we tend to look different. In our case, we are identical. We are the same people. We just happen to have had some differences in our history. And so it is not about the looks, it is not about racism, it is all about resources and a political system that has been set in place that disregards completely the race or the ethnicity that we are facing in Southern Cameroons. Now, there is the deliberate miseducation and brainwashing. It is no accident that in Cameroon today, and by Cameroon I mean both Cameroons, that we have two histories, that those who are in French Cameroon are taught one history, and us, we are taught a completely different history. So when we meet and we try to discuss our histories, it's very different, and we're discussing the same thing. For most French Cameroon students, they are taught that Southern Cameroons happens to be their territory that was lost through the Germans that they have reclaimed. Whereas we, and Prof has just taken us through the history as it is, and this is not just about history, it's about everything else. We have been brainwashed for the past 56, 57 years, and we are saying we do not want to be part of that system. So it is a comparison between something that is intrinsically evil and any other choice. We could choose to remain evil, or we could choose to be different, but at least we know that what we are faced with today is evil as a system. The dangers of multiple military allegiances. One of the challenges that South Sudan faces today is that of these multiple military allegiances, multiple military players based sometimes on ethnicity and so on. This is the challenge and the danger we face, which we are beginning. And when we listen to the ambassador's presentation, she showed you pictures of young men who are beginning to fight back. They are fighting back with whatever they have, whatever they can afford, from kitchen knives to everything. But the bottom line is that they are fighting back. Now, good always triumphs over evil. The danger is when the triumph, this victory, ends up being one where anarchy becomes the norm. When these young men without control, without any training whatsoever, they finally manage to take over territory, we will be sitting with another Sierra Leone, Liberia situation. So it becomes important that we start looking into this issue. And they're doing it. They're beginning to take chunks of territories for a few days, and they're beginning to fight back against the military. And it doesn't matter how much we tell them, listen, let's rather use the negotiation road. Let's use diplomacy. The young men have come to the point where they can take it no more, and they're saying we're going to fight back. When young men, if we have two or three young men who are organized enough in three different parts of that territory, and they are able to take territory and hold it, we have started a new Liberia, we have started a new Sierra Leone, and then it will become a regional thing. Because from the map that you've seen and which I've shown, Southern Cameroons happens to be a very, very strategic in terms of the Gulf of Guinea. Whatever kind of violence blows up there is going to affect 200 million people in Nigeria and another 55 million people across the other countries of Central Africa. We are the breadbasket of the region. So, but then these are some of the similarities with South Sudan. But moving forward, how do we allay those fears that people have been talking about? For me, the first is that unlike South Sudan, which all along had been subjugated and marginalized and discriminated against for the whole length of its history, Southern Cameroons comes from a background of having performed and practiced self-governance. We had democratic principles and practices as far back as 1954, before most African countries got their independence. And in fact, the gentleman who negotiated the union, or the purported union between Southern Cameroons and the Cameroons and the French Cameroons, happens to have won as a member of the opposition bench to be the prime minister and go into negotiations, which tells you that there was democracy in place. So we are not talking about the people who are coming from nothingness. It's the people who come with a history. Now, if there is an economist who wrote, and the book he wrote is The Bottom Billion, and he cautions against the fact that if something is not done to the bottom billion of the world today, we're going to descend into an abyss very soon where it will be almost impossible to rescue the world economically. And one of the elements he gives, which says that a country you need in order to be a country, is to have access to the ocean. And Southern Cameroons happens to have it, which was not the case with South Sudan. As a result, South Sudan faced a lot of difficulties economically and otherwise because of this lack of access to the ocean. I thought I should highlight that. The third key reason why I think Southern Cameroons will be different from South Sudan is that the literacy levels are very high. We actually are one of the highest on the continent. So we are not talking about a group of people who have been completely marginalized or completely disenfranchised of education to the point where there is nothing to show. Before the union with French Cameroon, we had very educated Southern Cameroonians. And what is happening today is that more and more, in spite of the hardship, the average Southern Cameroonian parent has tended to prioritize education above everything else. And which is, in my opinion, the major difference we have with South Sudan. The experience then about 10 years ago when I was there was that at least one out of every three male in South Sudan happened to have come from a military background, had been involved in the conflict in one way or the other, and was completely deprived of education, any kind of education, to the point where violence was very much the norm in terms of resolving conflict. That is not our case. Otherwise, what we are facing today is something that should have happened some 20, 30 years ago. We have a fairly influential and powerful diaspora. In fact, if there is any reason that the French Cameroon and its masters, the French, have failed to subdue the people of Southern Cameroons, is because of the very powerful diaspora that we have, which is in itself an accident. Sometimes even the best laid plans don't go according to plan. When the French Cameroon was discriminating and pushing and marginalizing Southern Cameroonians, many Southern Cameroonians had no choice but to leave the country and go to other places of the world, other parts of the world, in order to have opportunities. In the course of these past 30, 50 years, if you go into any and every field in this world, you will find a Southern Cameroonian, from science to the arts to everything. And it is this diaspora that is now pushing back. You cannot underestimate and you cannot neglect the position of 2 million citizens in any country, regardless. Self-sufficiency, like I said, Southern Cameroons happens to be the breadbasket of the region. 6 months in the Central African Republic when I was there, whenever the border between Cameroon and the Central African Republic was closed, there was complete hunger in the country because the Central African Republic depends almost entirely on Cameroon for its food supplies. The same holds for Gabon, the same holds for Chad, and most of the countries around. West of us, the same holds for Nigeria. So, again, self-sufficiency is something that we don't need to worry about. In fact, at the moment, and like she said, we've got 40,000 Southern Cameroonians who have fled our country into Nigeria. We haven't asked for the international community to come and help us. Southern Cameroon. Hey, yeah. Southern Cameroon. Not for Bamenda way, yade. Southern Cameroon. Now for my fear with me, I go pass. Southern Cameroon. Now for boya with me, I go lewa. Southern Cameroon. Now for Kumba with me, I go stay.
Make you pay the worker, so you don't get no problem, they shoot you for that door.
For that door, right? For that door.
Na for Mutengene, na for Mampu, na for Tombo, na for Mwa, na for Ombe, na for Limbe, na for Hey! Yeah! Where the freedom is, where them they beat us like this, yeah. Where the future of our kids, where them they brutalize us like this for streets. Where them good roads them day, where money walk out from Kumba to Mampu. Where the promises them day, where picking up the girls them to school. I know say pay battle, then for this level me, I don't know. Jackare folewa, police enter repam my swell, I don't know. Them the whip students them with sticks, them the slap lawyers them for streets. Them they follow we, they drag we, them molest we, they crack we like say we thief. Them they beat us, they carry us, they go. Them they mash we, they turn we for much. Them they throw away we, crashing water for skin up. Them they flow we take gas them for house. Hey! Southern Cameroon, not for Bamenda way, yeah, they. Southern Cameroon, not for Manfe with me, I go pass. Southern Cameroon, not for boya with me, I go lewa. Southern Cameroon, not for Kumba with me, I go stay. The pain is too much We cannot take it no more. Make una leave we, hey, we got survival. We are living in fear. All the bad people make una hear. Them say them go do this, go do that. They promise and fail. This time you don't fail. Then they mash we, they turn we for mud. Then they throw away we crashing what happens to now. Then they flood we will take us them for house. Hey! Southern Cameroon, not for Bamenda way, yeah, they.